All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the September 2022 Wild Science webinar from the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. Thanks, everybody, for joining us this morning. A couple of reminders, these presentations are being recorded and will be available to the public here in the next two or three days. We will be hearing today from Jacob Martin from Fisheries and Jessica Feltz from the Research Division. Jacob will be talking about electrofishing for catfish on the Ouachita River, and Jessica will be presenting about the WRICE program. Just a reminder to everyone, we will have some time at the end of each presentation for your questions. You can also type questions or comments that you'd like to have addressed in the comment function. So without any further ado, let's get started. Jacob will be presenting first. Jacob has worked for our agency as a fisheries management biologist out of the Camden office for a number of years. He's been with us for 3 years exactly, and also works on the catfish species management team. Prior to joining the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, he worked for Florida International University conducting research in the Everglades, and also worked for the Oklahoma Department of Wildlife Conservation. Jacob graduated from the University of Tennessee at Martin in 2014 with a Bachelor's of Science degree in Wildlife Management, and went on to earn a Master's degree from Arkansas Tech in Fisheries and Wildlife Science. Jacob grew up fishing for just about anything that would bite, and he enjoys targeting big fish, whether that's flathead catfish from the bank of a river or sharks in the Gulf of Mexico. He also often targets big fish with electrofishing gear, which is the subject of his presentation today, optimizing sampling protocols, evaluating how electrofishing settings affect the capture of flathead catfish in the Ouachita River. Jacob, take it away.
All right, Trey, thank you for that introduction. Can you guys hear me and see everything?
We have you loud and clear, and presentation format looks good.
All right. Well, as Trey mentioned, today I'm going to be talking to you guys about optimizing sampling protocols, evaluating how electrofishing settings affect the capture of flathead catfish. So to start off, I want to talk about why we do fishery sampling. So why do we sample fish populations? Well, we do this so that we can gather important information to inform our management decisions. And this information includes information on growth, mortality, and recruitment. And with these three things, we can effectively model regulations or monitor fish populations. So I'm going to talk about catfish sampling in Arkansas. I'm going to go over three different ways that we sample catfish, and then kind of talk about a real brief history of catfish sampling and catfish management. So to start off, one gear that we use to sample catfish is tandem baited hoop nets. And this gear is primarily used to target channel catfish. This is a series of three hoop nets with a bait in them that puts a scent out into the water column, and the channel catfish will swim into the nets. The next type of gear we use is unbaited hoop nets. So this is a single hoop net without any bait. We use this in a lot of our rivers and streams, and flathead catfish and channel catfish are the primary target here. They swim upriver into the hole in the net, seeking out some sort of habitat or shelter, and we're able to sample them that way. So both of these methods are passive gear methods, meaning that we set the nets out, we wait for the fish to swim in, and come back and see if there's any in there. An active sampling method that we use is low-pulsed electrofishing, and that's going to be what I'm talking to you guys mostly about today. And this is used to target blue catfish and flathead catfish. I'll also refer to this interchangeably as low-frequency electrofishing. It's the same thing. Catfish have been historically undersampled and undermanaged, and this isn't just a problem in Arkansas. This is a regional problem. Historically, there's been a lot of focus on species like bass and crappie, so those species have been studied extensively, but there really hasn't been a whole lot of management-focused research on catfish, especially flathead catfish. So flathead catfish are very popular for both recreational and commercial anglers. They have a very high trophy potential and can grow to over 100 pounds. The one pictured here is probably about 70 pounds. They're long-lived. They can live up to and sometimes over 20 years. And they're piscivorous, meaning that they feed primarily on fish. In fact, once they reach about 12 inches, probably 95% of their diet is going to be fish. And they're one of the least gape-limited predators we have meaning that any fish that can fit within that mouth is fair game for that flathead to eat. So large flatheads can eat pretty sizable fish. So I've mentioned low-pulsed electrofishing, and many of you have probably heard of high-frequency or bass electrofishing, and that differs from low-pulsed electrofishing in that we're putting out a higher frequency waveform. The majority of the fish will come up right between the droppers on the electrofishing boat, and the netters are able to net them up here. But with low-pulsed electrofishing, the majority of the fish are picked up kind of around the boat, anywhere up to 40 yards away in the connectivities that we're working in. And in fact, if a fish does come up in front of the boat, say right here, as that boat approaches, as the electrofishing boat approaches that fish, oftentimes it'll snap out of the stunned state that it's in and swim off once it gets close to these anodes. And I think that largely has to do with a difference in the electrical field right there between the anodes. So in low-pulsed electrofishing, we use what we call a chase boat. And that chase boat actually does the majority of the work, where the electrofishing boat just kind of floats downriver with the current. The chase boat will zoom around and net up all the fish that come up. I've got a video. We'll see whether or not it plays very well on here. But basically, the boat captains both have headsets on. We're able to talk to each other. And so I've told Dylan here that we've had a catfish come up on the other side of the tree, and they're going to boat on over there and pick that up. And that chase boat does the majority of the work and will get the majority of the fish. And Katie there is going to net that catfish and put it in the tub on the boat. So now real quick on why we're doing this project. So a lot of gear and sampling methods are often subject to bias. With our electrofishing for bass and our crappie netting, we often see that smaller fish are undersampled. So we're missing out on age zero bass when we go out and electrofish. We're missing out on age zero and age one crappie when we're crappie netting. And really, that's not that big of a deal because those fish are not fully recruited to the system yet. So what I mean by that is that they're not reproductive yet. They're not really catchable. So they haven't really contributed anything to the fishery yet. So just because you have a large number of small fish one year, that does not necessarily translate into a large number of slightly larger fish the next year. But with our low frequency electrofishing, some biologists are thinking that they're undersampling larger individuals. And these individuals are recruited to the system. They're reproductive and they're potentially trophy fish that we're missing out on. So biologists may go out to their reservoir or river and try a low frequency electrofishing sample and just not see a lot of big fish. But when they're at boat ramps doing creel surveys, they may be measuring big fish that anglers are catching, or they're seeing these big catfish show up on social media or in news articles, as is the recent case with some catfish caught out on Lake Conway. So my goal was to do a waveform comparison to try to optimize sampling and compare size distributions and catch per unit effort or catch per hour of these big fish. So the study area was the lower Ouachita River. We sampled in Felsenthal National Wildlife Refuge, which has about 52 miles of riverine habitat. It's made up of the Saline River and the Ouachita River, and it has a lot of backwater habitat. We also sampled the Thatcher Pool, which is just one pool up from the Felsenthal Pool. And this is 52 miles long. It's all the Ouachita River here, and it has very little backwater habitat. So our study design is that we use a Midwest Infinity electrofishing boat and chase boat. And I'll talk more about these things in a second, but one thing I wanted to point out about this electrofishing box is that you're really able to fine tune your pulses and your duty cycle. And the pulses is what makes it low frequency. So with bass shocking, a lot of times we use 60 hertz. With low frequency, a lot of times 15 hertz is used, so a low frequency waveform. And then duty cycle, you can choose whatever duty cycle you'd like, and I'll tell you guys more about that here in just a moment. So we got our power goals from Morris 2018, and power goals are basically a way to standardize our electrical output across a range of conditions. We used direct current 15 hertz or pulses, and we compared either 10% or 30% duty cycle. And duty cycle is basically the ratio of on time. And here's a way to visualize that. So we have on the y-axis is here, volts, and then on the x-axis is time. So we have a range of duty cycles presented here from zero, where we have zero on time, to 100%, where we have 100% on time, to 25% duty cycle, where you have 25% on, 75% off. 50% duty cycle would be 50-50 on off. And then 75% duty cycle would be 75% on, 25% off. So we had 21 sites within Felsenthal National Wildlife Refuge and 20 in Thatcher Pool. And these were randomly selected river kilometers that we sampled. At each site, we had two 10-minute electrofishing runs using a 10% and a 30% duty cycle. And we alternated which one was used first. Samples were conducted in early August 2021 in Felsenthal and early August 2022 in Thatcher Pool. Water temperatures were in the upper 80s, and we were working in relatively low conductivity, which is basically a measure of how well the water conducts electricity, at 80 to 110 microsiemens per centimeter. So when I present these results, I'm going to show Felsenthal first and then Thatcher Pool second and go back and forth like that. So first we have length histograms for Felsenthal National Wildlife Refuge. On the left, we have the 10% duty cycle. On the right, we have the 30% duty cycle. Here on the y-axis, we have percent of total. And on the x-axis, we have the length groups. And so the first takeaway here is that a similar number of fish were caught with both duty cycles. So we have 153 with the 10% and 132 with the 30%. And then next, we can see the 30% duty cycle created a drastically different shaped histogram here, where we have very left skewed, lots of small individuals made up the sample. Whereas with the 10% duty cycle, we have multiple peaks of abundance here. And we can see that we had a lot more large fish. So these red boxes are showing fish greater than 510 millimeters, or about 20 inches. We can see that the 10% duty cycle caught a lot more large fish than the 30% duty cycle. So here we have the same sort of histograms for the Thatcher Pool. And we have 10% on the left, 30% on the right. And once again, caught a similar number of fish, 80 with the 10%, 84 with the 30%. And these length histograms look a lot more similar. But once again, we can see we caught more small fish with the 30%. And when we look at fish over 20 inches, we can see that more large fish over 20 inches were caught with the 10% than the 30%. So now we're going to take a look at catch per unit effort, or catch per hour. And so here we have overall flathead catfish catch per unit effort for Felsenthal. We have the catch per hour on the y-axis and the duty cycle on the x-axis. So we have 10% on the left, 30% on the right. These are box plots, so the bolded line is the median. The box portion represents the data from the 25th to 75th percentile, and then the whiskers represent the rest of the data. So we can see these two data distributions are extremely similar. The medians are slightly different, but not statistically so. And when we look at Thatcher Pool, we see a similar story. These data distributions are once again extremely similar. The medians are virtually identical. In both pools with both duty cycles, we saw a similar number of fish caught per hour. But when we look at those larger fish over 510 millimeters or 20 inches, we see a different story. So here we have box plots once again, but these are for catch per hour of larger fish. We have 10% on the left, 30% on the right. And we can see there's quite a bit of difference between those medians, and these data distributions look quite a bit different as well. Here we have the data from the Thatcher Pool. These data distributions look a lot more similar, but the medians are quite a bit different. We have the median here for 10%, and then the median for 30% is basically hugging the zero line there. And what I want you guys to take away from this is there's a lot of zeros in this data set. So even with Felsenthal, those box plots are still hugging the zero line, and Thatcher Pool hugging the zero line. And so a lot of times when we're doing these sort of comparisons, we would use parametric statistics like ANOVA or t-test to see if there's any difference going on. But when you have a lot of zeros in your data, those tests are not appropriate. Luckily, there's a newer method out there called a zero inflated negative binomial model. And this model takes into account data that has a lot of zeros. So when we're thinking catch per hour of big fish, well, big fish are rare by definition, because you know they're older fish, so there's not as many of them out there. So you're going to have a lot of zeros in your data set. So this sort of model could be pretty beneficial for studies like this. So we found that catch per hour of large fish varied significantly with duty cycle. Here we have overall catch per hour for 10% on the left. And then for 30% on the right, and then those whiskers around it represent the error around those estimates. And what this zero inflated negative binomial model tells us is that catch rates of big flathead catfish with a duty cycle of 10 were 31% higher than a duty cycle of 30. So a duty cycle of 10 appears to be superior at sampling large catfish compared to the duty cycle of 30. As I mentioned, you catch about a third more fish with of these large fish with the duty cycle of 10. However, there was no difference in overall catch rates of flathead catfish. So this begs the question, does bigger fish mean a better sample? And I would argue that it does. So having these bigger fish consequentially means you have older fish as well, which is going to help us prevent overestimation of mortality. So if you're not picking up larger fish, then you're assuming that your fish are dying at a greater rate than they actually are. They're not achieving those older ages. And so you're going to overestimate your mortality. And you're also not going to be able to identify potential trophy fisheries if you're not able to collect those bigger fish. So while they may be there, you don't necessarily know that they are because you're not picking them up in your sample. And all of this leads to better management. So as I mentioned at the beginning, when we're sampling fisheries, we want to get a really good handle on mortality. And that's going to allow us to potentially project regulations to see whether or not that's going to impact the fishery, and it's going to help us monitor fisheries long term. The next question that this kind of brings up is, what does the true population look like? So is the 10% duty cycle actually oversampling large fish relative to what they are available, or is it sampling them at the rate that they are actually there? And so further research is needed to address this. We need additional waveform evaluations. And then, as I just said, are all sizes of catfish similarly susceptible to particular waveforms? And there's been some tank and lab studies that have tried to look at this. And my problem with a lot of those studies is that they're basically recreating the front of the electrofishing boat with their tanks. And as I mentioned earlier on in the talk, you know, the majority of these fish are not caught in front of the electrofishing boat. In fact, approaching these fish with the electrofishing boat will sometimes cause them to snap out of that stunned state that they're in and they'll swim off. So really, I think lab studies and tank studies need to try to focus on recreating the periphery of those waveforms or out towards the edge where a lot of these fish are being picked up by chase boats. And so collecting accurate and precise data is important to our job. So a study like this, you know, might not be as glamorous as some of the other stuff people have going on, but being able to evaluate what we're doing informs management, not only here in Arkansas, but also regionally as well. And with that, I'll take any questions.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions? Jacob, why did you select the 10 and 30 duty cycles to compare for this project?
So I know I just bashed on lab studies, but there's been some lab studies that have suggested that, you know, 30% is the way to go. And then 10% seem to have some potential at eliciting a surfacing response from larger fish. And so we wanted to see, well, are we going to lose out on our overall catch rate by switching to a 10%? Are we still going to catch a similar number of fish? And is it going to be more effective at sampling these larger fish? And so it seems like we really answered both those questions. We're catching the same number of fish, and it seems to be catching bigger fish.
All right. Who else has got questions? Okay. Jacob, thank you so much. Very informative presentation. Appreciate that.
Thank you.
All right. Next up is Jessica Feltz. Jessica is our agency's conservation social scientist working out of the research division in Little Rock. She's been with the agency for about 4.5 years and previously worked as the human dimension specialist in the Fisheries Division. Prior to joining Arkansas Game and Fish, she worked at the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. Jessica earned her bachelor's degree in wildlife and fisheries management from Mississippi State in 2013 and a master's degree in natural resources management from Auburn in 2015. Her master's project was a human dimensions research project to understand angler use and specialization at Alabama lakes. So here is Jessica Feltz in collaboration with Luke Naylor with WRICE, Partnerships and Benefits to Participants. The floor is yours, Jessica.
Okay, can y'all hear me?
We got you now. We got the presentation and now we hear you. Thanks, Jessica.
Perfect. Well, thanks for that introduction, Trey. I'm going to be talking about the WRICE program and what's unique about the partnership and how that really does benefit participants. But I'm going to acknowledge Luke Naylor. He is the Wildlife Management Chief. He's kind of my co-author on this talk, formerly the State Waterfowl Program Coordinator. And so I'm going to be giving the talk, but really any questions, any additional information, I'm going to put him on the spot and have him answer those questions if we get any. So we'll dive right in. So WRICE, or the Arkansas Waterfowl Rice Incentive Conservation Enhancement, is a program that AGFC started in collaboration with the USDA back in 2018, I believe. And the reason for WRICE's creation was to work with private landowners and to encourage and really incentivize the utility of alternative management action on for rice growing to benefit migratory waterfowl. So, but why rice? So rice and flooded rice fields provide wetland functions for waterfowl and other wildlife. And compared to historical rates, food for ducks in the rice fields have been kind of decreasing in the recent years. And a lot of this is due to the practice of fall tillage. And fall tillage reduces waste grain available to ducks that are trying to inhabit these areas. And so keeping this in mind, the original goal for RICE was to, again, incentivize landowners to adopt an alternative management action in order to not only benefit the wildlife and the waterfowl, but by providing incentive, they would hopefully be encouraged to adopt this behavior long term. And again, this is not asking them to like reduce harvestable rice or anything like that. It's just to kind of change up their action on their land based on like seasonality. And so the goal for WRICE was to focus on priority landscapes and priorities of the state. And I'll put up a map here in a second. Maintain and promote a natural flooding regime, and then again work with these private landowners to improve the management for waterfowl. So I mentioned those priority areas, and so on this map you'll see that the red are the wildlife management areas that are what we consider waterfowl focused in the state. The brown kind of blobs are the national wildlife refuges, and then anything in the orange is that 10-mile buffer around those waterfowl-centric management areas. And these are the areas we were focusing, or WRICE focuses on prioritizing enrolling landowners in the WRICE program. So like I mentioned, WRICE is a part of the NRCS through the Voluntary Public Access and Habitat Incentive Program. And the main goals are, to kind of reiterate, help farmers increase waterfowl food in the fields without any undue financial burden, provide a wildlife viewing and a limited permitted waterfowl hunt on these rice fields. And those that would be eligible landowners that have land in the wetland reserve easement program would be eligible for an additional financial incentive by opening up their property to a limited waterfowl hunt. And the hunting part of it started in the second year of the WRICE program. So this is a grant-funded program. It was originally, I think, 3, maybe 4 years was the original establishment. Luke will have to clarify that. And so the program was was in collaboration. It was granted for a predetermined number of years, and the first year had no, landowners were not obligated or encouraged to offer these hunts. And then in 2019, the program grew and they received an additional financial incentive to allow public hunting, limited public hunting on their property. And so in order to enroll in WRICE, the landowners had to meet a few criteria in order to meet, to be able to be enrolled in WRICE and therefore receive the incentive. So they had to suspend fall tillage, and they can choose from one of these three activities. Create shallow water development, either using being rainfall dependent or surface water pumping. And the surface water pumping does receive an extra financial incentive. And then again, for that additional dollar amount, allow permitted waterfowl hunting and wildlife viewing on their property. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today, really, is this, the benefit to the participants that kind of WRICE has created in terms of like for hunters and other wildlife viewers. So for the landowners that are enrolled, AGFC provides a number of kind of assistance to them in order to get this off the ground. So one, AGFC will come and post all the fields as special access areas. So you kind of see these signs here. There's designated parking areas. They help with all signage and maps. AGFC solely executes the weekly application and drawings for these weekend hunts throughout the season. And then we provide, like AGFC provides the information to the hunters about access instructions, where to go, where to park, things like that. We also are the primary, or really the only point of contact. We're that in between the landowner and the hunter if for some reason there's an issue. So we try to mitigate any of the burden to the landowner as it comes to dealing with the public. But in turn, the participants get a very awesome opportunity that allows them to hunt just about every weekend of the season. They can, hunters that are successfully drawn can take up to three additional people with them, and they allow all weekend hunt, all day weekend hunting. Obviously, they have to abide by any statewide regulations and limits. So for this part, I'm going to focus really on the results from a post-hunt survey from the 21-22 waterfowl season. So this is the most recent season. We've been doing the survey since the hunts began in 2019. So we do have a comparative data over time, and I'll kind of touch on that at the very, very end. But since it started, the hunts were allowed in 2019, the WRICE program has really taken off, honestly. So from the last season, there's been about 40 fields that were available each weekend that allowed for hunting. Over 1,300 unique individuals applied to hunt in one of these fields, and 300 unique individuals were drawn. Again, a person could be apply in a draw for multiple fields. So these are just truly individual people. And you'll kind of see average applicants per field ranged from 1 to 22. Like anything else, there are these perceptive better or higher quality hunt opportunities for some fields compared to others. But we really do, I mean, what I wish we could just screen to the public, and when they ask, I think Luke does a great job of doing this, is tell them that, look, like if you want a really solid chance of getting drawn, we post the applicants and the draw numbers and the applicants up on the WRICE part of the AGFC website. And so really it's an odds game. If you really want an opportunity to be drawn, like, pick the field that has maybe fewer applicants. But also, I don't think the public really realizes, yes, this is a landowner field, so a lot of the responsibility in terms of the quality of the hunt and the field are up to the landowner, but these landowners are working extensively with AGFC staff. And again, all landowners have to meet a certain criteria to be enrolled in WRICE. And so there are ample, excellent hunting opportunities on all of these fields. And so it blows our mind when we see a certain field or a number of fields have just dozens of applicants and some just have one or two dozen. Because really the rice fields are all designed to provide the highest quality level of that would, wetland habitat that would attract these migratory waterfowl. So like I mentioned, after each hunt, again, this started in 2019, but I'll focus on the most recent season. After each hunt, so the hunt's a weekend, that following business week, usually somewhere between, it's ranged anywhere from Monday to Wednesday, we've kind of settled that Tuesday seems to be the best date in order to where people can take the survey, they feel engaged enough, and there's little recall issues when taking the survey. But it's not like, you know, they finish their hunt on Sunday and the first thing Monday at 6 a.m. they're getting an inbox. So we're trying to be respectful of the hunter's time. And so we've kind of toyed with that over the last few seasons. But so Tuesday following the hunt, applicants will receive an email to complete a post-hunt survey. And we have all their contact information because obviously they applied for the hunt. We send it to those that were only successful, so those that were drawn for each hunt. The survey is open about 7 days, and it does include one completion reminder. So the survey is electronic, and it has a variety of questions to not just get at, like, did you enjoy your hunt, but we're looking at more contextual, more concept things about what about this opportunity for WRICE. Is this an opportunity that provides a unique opportunity, or is it just kind of, if it's one that's, you know, I'll take advantage of it in passing if I'm able to, if not, no big deal. We really wanted to identify the true the opportunity that WRICE was providing to hunters. So over these past couple of years, we've seen response rates to the survey as high as 70%. So I showed a couple slides ago that we had over 1,300 unique applicants, about 300 were successful in drawing a hunt. And we have over 200 plus responses from the 21-22 waterfowl season from people that indicated that they recognized they were drawn successfully and they did not hunt, or that they did hunt and went on to complete the survey for us, which is really excellent. From the 21-22 season, the average age of a WRICE participant was about 35 years old. But as you can see from this graph, this program is attracting every type of hunter. It's obviously very, very attractive to first-time hunters or younger hunters because it's a more controlled environment. And so I think parents who are trying to take a youth hunting, or even somebody that's hunting for the very first time, the appeal of WRICE, if they're able to be drawn, is very interesting because it provides, yes, it's open to the public, so equal opportunity drawing to be drawn for the hunt, but it provides that private land feel. You know, that limited interaction, no other hunters, that type of really highly desirable hunting scenario, we get to recreate that with WRICE. And I think that's what makes it really attractive to a number of hunters. So then we asked a number of questions because we wanted to know, again, what is WRICE really bringing to the hunters of Arkansas? So we asked, not including yourself, did you take any of the following persons hunting? These are the numbers here, and you can kind of see, I lost my percentage, but so a number of people, so about 10% of people said that they took a first-time hunter in general when they hunted during their WRICE hunt. A little more than that said they took a first-time waterfowl-specific hunter, so this was their first time waterfowl hunting, but not hunting in general. And then even more people said that they took someone who had not been hunting in a while. And these were trends. So this set of questions was one that we started asking in the most recent season, I believe, really to just try to, again, get at that holistic concept of what is WRICE bringing to participants in terms of opportunity and access. We also wanted to know, how often do they typically waterfowl hunt in each season? Wondering if the WRICE program is attractive to, you know, more established waterfowl hunters, or is it really seen as an opportunity for newer waterfowl hunters or sole private public land hunters. So from 21-22, we had two people outright acknowledge that this was their first season waterfowl hunting. Again, a little over, I think it's like 12%. They go about 1 to 3 times per season. So this really is primary opportunity for them to hunt. Most of the respondents did say that they hunt more than 10 times per season. So again, WRICE is a kind of a once in, I don't want to say lifetime, but once in a season, kind of a limited opportunity. I'll go hunting if I get a WRICE permit, maybe, but otherwise I probably won't bother. WRICE is attracting that type of hunter. But we also know largely WRICE is just an additional opportunity for hunters to hunt in areas that they wouldn't normally get the opportunity to. And that's even great, because we know that longevity in hunting, it's a tradition, it's a valued sport, but success is a key indicator of participation. And so if we can provide opportunities for hunters and then also increase their opportunity for success in terms of seeing ducks, harvesting ducks, then it's likely that they will continue to participate in subsequent years. So then we just outright asked, if you did not draw a WRICE permit, would you have waterfowl hunted this season at all? Most people went ahead and said yes, they would. But, I mean, a significant portion said no, or even maybe, I'm unsure. So again, we know WRICE is a unique opportunity that not only benefits waterfowl and migratory wildlife and wetland and wildlife that use a wetland habitat, it provides an incentive to landowners to explore alternative management opportunities on their private lands. But it also creates an opportunity for hunters to get an experience that sometimes and otherwise they probably just really wouldn't have been able to do, or would have not felt they wanted to do, or it wasn't worth their time without the opportunity of WRICE. And so we did ask their overall hunting satisfaction on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being poor, 5 being excellent. The gray bar on the far right is the 3-year average, but the green bar is from the 21-22 season, and it averages about 2.5. So that's about good on a scale of 4 to excellent. And we know a number of things drive hunt experience, hunt satisfaction in their experience. So obviously, like I mentioned before, success is a key indicator of satisfaction. So duck seen, duck shot. On public lands, we know water levels are a really big key indicator, but again, part of WRICE is required to maintain some sort of shallow water development. And then weather. We can't really control the weather, so we can't really help that. But another factor for WRICE that we don't really see that impact satisfaction for, let's say, public land hunting is like the quality of the hunt site. So largely, AGFC works with the landowners to develop these blinds and spots. And AGFC staff are not out there every week cleaning them out, drying them out. You know, we can't help rain or any other type of weather. And so we have gotten a number of comments from participants saying they were really dissatisfied with the blind or where they were set up, or really the where they were asked to hunt was not really well concealed. We've gotten complaints about lack of signage, poor maps, poor roads or access, limited access for mobility impaired persons. But the benefit of doing a survey like this is so that each year we can identify where these people are hunting and what is impacting their experience, so that if it's a solution that's attainable with the landowner, we have staff that can go back to the landowner and encourage a change, or we can work with the landowner to try to adapt something. But largely there are some restrictions that we just cannot help. You know, I would say probably the number one request we get from landowners is, I would like to scout the area prior, or they would like to bring an ATV in order to get to the designated blind. And the response to that is like, we just don't allow that. There's a safety issue. There's a safety concern for the landowner and for the hunters. There's a lot of liability that goes into that. And we recognize that in order to be successful, we know that scouting is such a core part of hunting. So there are limitations and we recognize that. And so though we'd like to see an overall higher rating for experience, we know there are just some things that WRICE, there's some limitations and some sideboards to the program that are going to have to remain in place in order for the longevity and the success of the program to continue in subsequent years. But largely, lots of positive feedback we do receive. These are all hunts are all photos provided to us from WRICE participants. None of these are staged. And you can read these comments wanting to say thank you. This gives hunters an opportunity that they don't have to hunt a lot of places to go waterfowl hunting. The second comment there is actually from the female that's shown in the bottom left photo. She went out of her way and emailed us last season. Her name is Courtney, and this was her very first waterfowl hunt, and she got her very first duck. Her husband scored his first ever banded goose, And she said she connected with her first ever duck. Very complimentary. It was a very nice email to receive. And then largely we do get a lot of thank you, no complaints. This is an amazing program. And again, for the people that don't provide an overall positive response or they do provide more constructive criticism to us, a lot of it has to do with some of the limitations I just mentioned that really are outside of our control. And again, the best we can do is work with landowners, but we do try to communicate with the participants that, you know, this is an opportunity and we will do our best to provide the highest quality experience. But there are some limitations in that we have to kind of abide by in order to make this program successful. And largely people do understand that. And we do see a number of people that return year to year to continue to apply for WRICE. So with that, I, the proxy of Luke Naylor, would be happy to answer any questions if he's on the call. And yeah, thanks for your time.
Thanks, Jessica. I do believe Luke is in the meeting. And I, as someone who has hunted a number of these WRICE fields over the past few years, I've had some hunts that were exceptional and some that were zeros. And, you know, that's always a big contributing factor into how we rate things. But I would to follow up that middle of the road rating, we could give a new duck call and a box of shotgun shells to some of these folks that draw, and they'd still be unhappy and complain about it being the wrong brand or the wrong size shot or something like that. So you're never going to make everybody happy. Any questions from our colleagues that are here on this call? Jessica and or Luke, I will throw one out. I mean, you know, I know this program has grown every year. What's the ceiling on this? How far can we go? I mean, how much can we expand this thing?
Hopefully Luke will unmute himself. I can just tell you from my perspective, he's going to have a more hands-on response, more in-depth response. But so WRICE is continued for, the original grant continues through this season. I believe we have funds that will extend the program for a couple more seasons. So WRICE is not going away anytime soon, which is excellent. And hopefully we're going to try to adapt WRICE and look at it from the landowner perspective in the coming years to try to figure out what else could we do to incentivize more landowners to seek to want to enroll in WRICE. Because it's my understanding, if Luke is on the call and you get into this, we have a pretty high landowner acceptance rate when people apply to be in WRICE. And so, but we would like to see more of that. But if we can't, then could we use WRICE as a platform to continue to encourage other landowners that choose not to enroll or enroll and then disenroll to continue to adopt these behaviors? You know, again, this isn't just about providing a hunting opportunity. It's providing quality waterfowl and wetland habitat for wildlife and migratory waterfowl. And the goal is to get as many landowners to explore the possibility of adopting these land management actions. I don't know if Luke can unmute himself.
I think he's there now.
Okay.
Yeah, I can handle that, I think. Can you hear me, Trey?
I got you. And I was gonna, before you start, like Holly, we'll get to your question in just a second after Luke responds to that.
Yeah, short answer is, yeah, I mean, this started out as a habitat program primarily, but the grant funds we went after are focused on public access, which is also something we're interested in. So we actually worked with the Natural Resources Conservation Service this year to provide some additional funding for the habitat management side of the program. And that'll allow us to, this year we're looking at going from about 40 to 45 unique fields available each weekend, about 60 to 70. Because of some additional funding available that allows us to spread our dollars farther and will actually allow us to carry the program into next year without additional grant funds, we think. So, and we're continuing to work with a bunch of folks on what the program looks like after 2023, 2024.
All right. Thanks, Luke. Holly Sanders says she'd like to see the responses from the participants' experience survey, and also if we facilitated wildlife watching experiences on WRICE, would you want to survey those participants?
Yes, Holly. We've got some of those responses is what Jessica showed. Some of it we've got more details on that on some of the hunting participant surveys. The problem is with wildlife viewers, the catch there is identifying who those people are. We do not establish their access. We have no permit in our system for wildlife viewing, or no other way to know who is actually going out and doing wildlife viewing on these areas, if anybody. So without offering a free or very low cost permit that folks have to have, just essentially to just get registered so we can survey them and figure out what their experiences were and how we can improve. Without having a way to register wildlife non-hunters, we are essentially out of luck. We don't know who that population is, unless it's an AGFC facilitated trip to one of these places, which I don't think any of those have happened so far.
Luke and or Jessica, I know from conversations I've had with you, Luke, that you've gotten mostly positive feedback from these landowners, from these rice farmers. Jessica alluded to maybe the desire moving forward to, you know, more formally survey them to see what their opinions are. Given that we haven't done that, but based on the anecdotal evidence, what are the farmers? What's their reaction to this program?
They like it. Of course, the rental payment is good. That's part of what we want to survey, get some real information about price points and how we can a long-term program would look like as far as pricing goes, for example. But, you know, we've had very, very few of the hundreds of, dozens of fields each year and hundreds of different members of the public getting drawn and going out to hunt these places. It's really, over the years, I've really about just a handful, maybe just a few times where there's somebody they drove just a little bit past a sign and rutted up a road, for example. But that's out of hundreds of opportunities for stuff like that to happen. You've got two or three or four of them that I've actually been told about by landowners. So I think people, they understand that we're doing our job at Game and Fish to manage the program, and hunters are by and large respecting the property when they're out there.
All right. Anybody else before we wrap this thing up? Okay. Thanks to Jacob and to Jessica and Luke as well, and to all of you for participating in this month's Wild Science webinar. And we'll see you in October. Thanks, everybody.